The message that I want to talk about, preach about, is titled Light Rejected Becomes Darkness Deepened. Light Rejected Becomes Darkness Deepened. And so, in any capacity of your walk with God, or where you are with God, whether you've already accepted Christ, whether you've never accepted Christ, whether you are backslidden, that statement right there, that title, it still has the same effect. If God's speaking something to you, God's telling you to do something, to stop doing something, whatever the case, that light that is shining, if you reject it, it's going to deepen the capacity or the ability of darkness to come in, if it's already in, to go deeper inside of you. And so it's very important for us to be extremely attentive to the things that God has said to us. It's very important for us to be attentive to what the Holy Spirit is convicting our hearts about. It's our mission in life, our mission as believers is to reflect that light. And, you know, I feel like God kind of gave me some other small missions, like don't embarrass my daughter in public, which, you know, I think I failed miserably at that. But, I mean, you know, when you go through a drive-thru, it's just this, I don't know what it is for me, but that's just the best time to do it, you know? But God has truly given us that mission. You know, we do have it laid on us. There's a lot of scripture about light. There's a lot of scripture, and I wasn't able to grab all of them. But Genesis chapter 1, verses 3 through 4, that's one of them. Genesis 1, 3 through 4, that's the first record, you know, if you look at the Bible and the way it was canonized, the way it was sorted in order, that's the first record of light where it's mentioned. It says, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God can choose, He can do anything He wants, how He wants. If God wanted to have the light sitting right in the middle of the darkness, or the darkness sitting in the middle, you walk into a room with light, and it's like, that's weird, right there in the middle, there's darkness. God just decided that He was going to separate light, and He was going to separate darkness, and that's just the way it is now. Just the way gravity works. It's the way that law works. And so, God did it specifically, I believe, one of the primary reasons is so that He could communicate to us who He is, because He said that He is the light. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And so it brings a really strong illustration as to who He is and His effect in reference to darkness. And then vice versa. And so it's really interesting, and some of it's real elementary, but if you look at the characteristics of light and darkness, it's really interesting how it'll help our understanding and our knowledge of God's Word. John 9:5, that's another one. I must work the works of Him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. So what He was saying is, while He was there present with the disciples, preaching to the multitudes, teaching, rebuking the scribes, the Pharisees, all the religious ones who were real churchy, you know, and totally beside the point, He was the light. And that light came in, and I mean, it really offended those religious people. It exposed a lot of their dark deeds, and it showed what the intent of their heart truly was. And the disciples, it did the same thing to them. It exposed their deeds, and it showed what their intent was, all the way from Peter to Judas to John, all of them. And you, as you look through Scripture, you will see, you'll absolutely see how that effect was on them. And 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. This then is the message which we have heard of Him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us from all sin. Through the light, we have that direct access to be washed and to be cleansed by His blood. And the access is so so much easier to get to when you have that understanding, when you are in Christ, when you are living for Him. And to be quick to repent, as David was, very quick to make things right. That's what will keep that darkness from deepening in us, because we are going to sin. We do have that sinful nature that we are struggling with. And the thing is, it doesn't have to be so much of a struggle if we have the understanding of how to get victory over it. Mm-hmm. And we understand what the source is, and we understand who's the one who can break that power. There's an aircraft that I heard someone talking about. It was a really great illustration. And there's many different illustrations to show the power of the cross, okay? And the power of what that does in relation to the sin nature that we have. But it was the precursor to the stealth. And this aircraft would travel so fast, it was just insane. I mean, it was like 160,000 horsepower. And it traveled close to, I don't know if it was quite 2,000 miles an hour. This was back in the 1960s was when it was actually built. And it was still around until the 90s, long before the stealth. And this thing had the capacity to outrun missiles. When they would shoot missiles at it, the missiles would never find it, never catch up to it. I mean, we just totally leave it in dust. And that is an outstanding example of what the power of the cross will do in light of your sin nature. You can get so far ahead of it if your faith remains there. That's the kind of generated power that you're dealing with. And to truly understand that and bring it home, the power of that is amazing. But the thing is, we still carry this body of sin, this shell that we are in. And so to expect that you won't sin, to expect that it's not going to happen, that the aircraft's going to run out of gas or something's going to go wrong, it's just not possible that won't happen, you know. But that's really how it is for us. And so I just want to encourage you in that. When I heard it, it was like, man, that's what I'm talking about. It was really, really good. We're going to break down. We're going to get deeper in the Word here. I just wanted to give you some of these scriptures on light. John 5:35, he was a burning and shining light, and you were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. Talking about John the Baptist. He was a burning and shining light, and you were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. And that word light right there in the Greek is lupnos. And what it actually means is it's a portable lamp. It's a hand lamp, something carried by hand, fed by oil. It burns for a time, and then it goes out. When it runs out of oil, that's it. And that was the comparison to the reflected light, so to speak. John the Baptist was a form of reflected light from God. But when you look at Jesus and how he calls himself light, he refers to himself in John 8:12, then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. And I got to brush up on my pronunciation in the Greek, but phos or phos is the word for light. And it means to shine, make manifest, to give light. And there's no connection to it burning out. There's no connection to anything like that. There's a vast difference between what we are able to do through reflecting him and through representing him, as opposed to what he does and who he is. Amen. And so there's a couple of stories that I wanted to brush over. So I'm going to do a quick review overview going through the book of Acts. And I mean very quick and very brief on the overview side of this. In Acts chapter 1, it talks about how they assembled in Jerusalem. Jesus met with them in verse 4, and he commanded them to wait. He told them, he promised them that the Holy Spirit was going to come upon them. I mean, he had been talking about it, you know, before he had died on the cross. At this point, he already died on the cross, okay? And he had come back, and he appeared to them. And when he met with them, he's telling them, okay, now remember, this is the plan. We went over all this stuff, but, you know, it's unlikely that they were going to remember everything. So he went over it again, And he told him, you know, this is what I want you to do. And I'm going to leave. And when I leave, you know, that's it. The light as you know it is gone. But there's another light that's going to come. And it's going to dwell inside of you. And that is the Holy Spirit. And that is what we're experiencing right now, is the power of the Holy Spirit through what he did at the cross. And so that power, it actually, it makes it exponentially much more able, you know, because every one of us can walk away with that light of the Holy Spirit in us. And so it's a really powerful concept. It's more than a concept. It's not an it, it's a he. He is amazing, you know, that he can do that, that he can give a part of himself. It's not even a part of himself. It's all of himself right there inside of you and you and you, all of us. And that's what's just amazing. It's like here we are in our flesh trying to comprehend this, trying to understand that. So we have to get out of this carnal way of thinking and take on, you know, a spiritual mindset. And that's what he does. He gives us the capacity to do that. So he's telling them, you know, we're going to get together. We're together. We're in Jerusalem. I want you guys to wait. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit after I leave. And so then he actually leaves. In verse 5, that's when it, or in verse 5, he tells them about the promise of the Holy Spirit. In verses 9 through 11 of chapter 1, he tells them, he actually ascends into heaven. That's when Jesus leaves. And you don't see any fear. You don't see any doubt. You don't see anybody concerned. You know, they were waiting. And they were getting ready for the Holy Spirit. And so in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit descends on them. In verses 1 through 4, he happens. He happens. The Holy Spirit comes down and descends on them. And Peter comes out from that. They're speaking in tongues, right? And he comes out from that initial outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and he starts to preach because people are looking around on the streets like, man, this is really weird because we've got all these people here for this feast, and many languages represented, they're speaking other languages themselves, and we know these are Jews, probably by the accent, by the way they were dressed. They knew that they were Jews, and so what is up with that? You know, for them to be speaking all these different languages. So Peter was like, hey, there's no time like the present time. So he took advantage of the opportunity and he preached the message. And he told them exactly what was going on. And he talked about the stammering lips that was spoken of in the Old Testament. And was it Joel, I believe? Yeah, all of it had already been spoken ahead of time. And so he's quoting the scriptures because some of these are Jews that are questioning this. Like, what's up with this? And they would understand those scriptures in the Old Testament. And so he's explaining all that. And so what ends up happening in verse 37 is conviction comes down or comes upon them. And that's the Holy Spirit again. That's a work of the Holy Spirit, is when conviction actually comes on a person. And then after that, 3,000 souls were converted to Jesus.
Amen.
That was the first recorded 3,000. I believe that was the first 3,000. The Bible in and of itself was not intended just to be a history book. I mean, we know that. It's the inspired word of God. But there is a lot of history there. And so according to the record of the way things went down, and even based on some of the other historians, you know, that's the first record that I know of that I've ever read about, where 3,000 souls, these first converted to Christ and became what later they started to call them Christians. And That was verse 41. And then miracles, wonders, and signs were actually happening. And souls were added daily. It just was continually people coming into the kingdom of God and becoming a part of this new thing they call the church. And so that was in verse 47 at the very end of chapter 2. Acts chapter 3, a lame man was healed. I believe it was Peter and John. Yeah, they laid hands on this man, and he gets healed. And what happens after that is everybody's like, oh man, whoa, this is crazy, you know? I mean, they're marveling, the Bible says. They actually marvel. And what that word means, thumazo, wonder and admiration is what it actually means. Wonder and admiration. That's the way they were looking at Peter. They weren't looking at the miracle so much. And even just looking at the miracle is not enough. You know, just to have your eyes on what was done. But they were so focused and they were so fixed on Peter and John. And there's a reason for that, which we're going to talk about later. A little bit more of a reason. That was in verse 12. And then Peter asked them, he says, "Why look ye so earnestly on us?" And with that word, earnestly, atenizo, boy, these Greek words are awesome. Having to pronounce them. It means to fix the eyes intently upon. They were so into Peter and they were so into John. You know, not so much who it really was that had performed this miracle. Amen. And this wonder. And the whole point of it is to point people to Christ. Amen. Is to bring people into the kingdom. Lord. And of course, because he cares about people that are suffering. And he wants to, you know, he wants to heal people that are in various situations where they need a healing. But they were just so fixed on them. And so they did their part. They did handle it the right way. And they were refocusing them to Jesus. And that's why Peter was asking, "Why are you looking so earnestly at us?" And so one of my first points that I really wanted to make was that darkness attempts to divert and distract from the mission. Darkness will always, always try to distract and divert. Distract and divert. I mean, that's one of Satan's most obvious and powerful missions. If he can keep you from keeping your focus on the blood of Christ, because that's where the power is, you do understand that, right? I mean, the way I see it is the power, the cross, what Jesus did at the cross is like a big, huge, massive, I mean, I'm talking several miles wide generator. It's the most powerful generator that the world has ever seen or ever will see. And that's what it represents to me. And from that generator comes these extensions, these channels in which God's grace can flow to us. And I see prayer as a channel of God's grace. My faith is not in my ability to pray, as you've heard, you know, that we should not do that. But it is a very good act, and it's a good work. And it's a channel that God's grace will come through, but it all flows from the power of what he did at the cross.
Right.
The foundation is always going to be the cross. And to move on to bigger and better things is like the most contradictory statement that could ever be made. Because there are no bigger and better things. Because everything is on that foundation. So in essence, you'll always be on that. You'll always be standing on top of that. No matter what you're doing. No matter what kind of religious, I don't want to say religious, good work that you're doing for Christ. It all comes from that foundation. Because if the power of the cross was taken away, then the Holy Spirit is withdrawn from the situation at the same time. And any good works, they'll just shrivel up. It's just not going to happen. Any good, powerful flow to that, it's cut off. It's done. Because the generator. You have to have the generator in order to have the grace, the power that flows through those channels. And so, what happened last Sunday, water baptism, I see that as a channel of God's grace. We're not putting our faith in water baptism, and we already know that you don't have to be water baptized to be saved, per se. You should be water baptized, definitely, out of obedience to his command, and also following his example, because Jesus was baptized, not because he had to be baptized. He didn't need to be baptized, you know, for any specific reason, except he made an example and he showed us the proper way. And so that's a channel in which God's grace can come to us. And those of you who were water baptized, you experienced the power of God through that.
Amen.
You experienced his grace because you were being obedient and your faith was still in what he did at the cross. And you were experiencing the grace that comes through that channel. And so another channel of God's grace could be this right here, this church attendance. The communion, when we take communion, it's a channel. It's just a channel. It's a tool. God wants to make you a channel of his grace. Amen. God wants to make you that tool or that piece that he can flow through to reach other people with that grace. So darkness attempts to divert and distract from the mission. They were seeking a sign. Mark 8, 11 through 12, he talks, Jesus was talking about this. I'm going to look this one up. And the Pharisees came forth and began to question with him, seeking of him a sign from heaven, tempting him. And he sighed deeply in his spirit and saith, "Why does this generation seek after a sign? Verily I say unto you, there shall no sign be given unto this generation. And I wanted to focus on where it says he sighed deeply. That's the only place in the New Testament. There was another reference. I mean, it's a totally different language, right? The Hebrew is what's applied in Aramaic, is what's applied to the Old Testament. But there was a reference there. The only place in the New Testament where it says he, where it uses that Greek word, that where he sighed deeply. I mean, gosh, I'm just glad that I wasn't in that audience and being a part of, you know, of that thing to make him sigh deeply. For Jesus to go, you know, I mean, seriously, that was pretty immense, you know, from what I'm seeing. And that word right there, where he's talking about sighing deeply, is anastenazo. It's a Greek word that means deep drawn. That sigh is a sigh that I don't know that we've ever experienced or not. But I mean, it came from way down deep. And it really, really grieves Jesus in a really big way. It's very important that we keep our eyes fixed on Him and what He did. And it's okay to look at what he's doing. It's okay to rejoice in it because, I mean, it's biblical. We see that. And I'd be crazy not to rejoice in what he's doing. But to seek that, that's all wrong. You know, that's so backwards to be seeking after that. It also means not just deep drawn, but also to groan. Matthew 12:38-39 was another case where they were asking to see a sign. They wanted to see a sign. They wanted to see something. It appears to be a very Jewish thing. They're all about the signs, you know. He was talking about circumcision this morning. That was a sign. You know, it kind of goes hand in hand with the, I believe there was a washing, a water immersion or something that went hand in hand with the circumcision. And then, you know, I look at it like our circumcision, in a sense, is compared to water baptism in the New Testament. You know, that's our sign, because that's what it is when we get water baptized. It's an outward sign of that inward reality of something that has already taken place. We've already been washed in the blood. We've become born again. And so, he says, he calls them an evil and adulterous generation who seek signs. Diversion and distraction from the mission. That's what it was all about. Are we just going to be hanging out here just performing miracles all day, but nobody comes to Christ? I mean, what really is the end? You know, what's the conclusion for that? You know, where does that take us in the end? Nowhere. Nowhere. Because that body that gets healed is going to eventually die, and then eternity. And then judgment. You know, so they were totally missing the point. And that's what the enemy wants to do. That's what the devil wants to do. He'll use anybody. He'll use anything to try to distract and to try to divert. And he wants to divert you. He wants to divert me and distract us on our jobs, at home, with our families, our children, our spouse. You know, he wants to do that. And so if we're not paying attention, you know, to what's happening, you know, we can get in the flesh, we can argue, we can fight, we can wrestle with that flesh and blood and not realize that it's the enemy. It's the enemy trying to destroy our families, trying to break us down so that the church breaks down, so that the world's not reached at the capacity that it should. And so, Acts chapter 4, Peter and John preach. They get imprisoned over the resurrection. They get imprisoned by the Sadducees as a religious group. Their big thing was they didn't believe in resurrection. They didn't believe that that was a possibility. Well, Jesus had already died and resurrected. So that kind of blew that out the water. It really blew it out the water. And they didn't want to hear it. They didn't want to hear that message preached. And so they took it very personal. And that's the reason that they were imprisoned over that. And in the process, not long after, you know, they wanted to question him and talk to him, and they wanted to put him in the middle of a big crowd of people and start asking them all these hard questions to say, yeah, I don't know if it was to maybe get them to get stumped and have influence over the crowd, because the crowd, they were getting saved. You know, they were buying in. They were converting and becoming believers. And so what ends up happening while they're in the midst of all these people, 5,000 get saved. You know, they end up getting converted because the light overpowered the darkness that day.
Yes.
The light always does overpower the darkness if we'll just allow it to reflect, if we'll simply allow that to happen. And they go on and they testify and continue to defend the gospel with these Sadducees and other religious leaders that are questioning them. So light, when it's embraced, it will produce unity and devotion. It will produce unity and devotion. So in that same chapter 4, verse 32, it talks about how they had all things in common. They took all their possessions. They were selling all their stuff. They would bring the money back to the church and they would just give it. And then we're not talking about socialism. It was just a concept that they wanted to do because there were a lot of people that had some really big needs, and there was a lot of people that were very able, you know, to go sell land, go do what they could to bring in more money so they could have more money to meet the needs of the people that had needs. And so that's the reason that they were doing it. And so Barnabas was a good example of someone who sold all. He sold everything that he had. He sold all his land. He brings the money back. He sold what he had. He gave the money, all the money that he had made off of it, he gave it to the church so that they could meet some more of those needs. In verse 36, it talks about that. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. And Joseph, who by the apostles was surnamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation, a Levite and of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. Okay, Acts chapter 5. I'm going to read verses 1 through 11. Acts 5, 1 through 11. But a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price. His wife also being privy to it and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? Whilst it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. And great fear came on all them that heard these things. And the young men arose, wound him up, and carried him out and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours after, when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto her, Tell me whether you sold the land for so much. And she said, Yes, for so much. Then Peter said unto her, How is it that you have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door, and shall carry you out. Then fell she down straightway at his feet, and yielded up the ghost. And the young men came in, and found her dead, and carrying her forth, buried her by her husband. And great fear came upon all the church, and upon as many as heard these things. Darkness always produces lies and deceit. Always. It will eventually manifest. Ananias and Sapphira, they sold everything, but they only gave back a portion. It was their choice. It was their choice, but they lied about it. Where it says in verse 4, why hast thou conceived this thing? The word conceived, it actually is referring to something that was premeditated. How many of you have conceived a baby? It's not a spur of the moment thing. It's from that context of the word. It was premeditated. So they thought this out. They planned it out. What was really the motive? Were they trying to make themselves look like they were, you know, one of the heroes, or I don't know, they were trying to give glory to themselves because they were giving more money, or wow, they sold everything they had, but they were holding money back, and they were telling people, apparently, that, you know, they were giving it all. And so it was for some kind of It was for some kind of appearance, you know, that wasn't the case. And it was so trivial, it was like, why? You know, why? It was so not worth it. But that's what darkness will do. That's what darkness will do if we allow it in. It never has enough. It never has enough. It wants to take up as much space and as much area inside of us as we will allow. Yes. Darkness always produces lies and deceit. Eventually it will. Acts chapter 8, verses 1 through 25. Y'all know the story about Simon Magus, the sorcerer? I know he's talked about it. I know pastors talked about it in here before. Acts chapter 8, okay, verses 1 through 25. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and hailing men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them. And many taken with palsies, and that were lame, were healed. And there was great joy in that city. But there was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one. That's really key right there. To whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. And so he was getting what he wanted, because just before that, he was giving out to them of himself. He was telling them about himself, that he was just some great, you know. Actually, there's other records about Simon Magus that I'm going to read you. It's historical. It's not biblical. But where he actually was proclaiming himself to be a god. To whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, verse 10, saying, this man is the great power of God. And to him they had regard, because that of long time he had bewitched them with sorceries. Now, isn't it a shame to have to absolutely control somebody just to pull out of them what you want them to say about you? Mm-hmm. That's how darkness works, the deception and the forcefulness and the manipulation. Verse 12, but when they believed Philip preaching, notice verse 12, but. There's a big but. Sometimes you need a big but in a sermon. Verse 12, but they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Then Simon himself believed also. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. Okay? So you see what his focus was. He was wondering, but all he was wondering about was those miracles and those signs. You know, how has this happened? Because there were things he was doing already in order for him to be exalted with the people. And so he saw something that he didn't have. He recognized that. And so his focus was just on those miracles and signs. Verse 14, now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them yet, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And when Simon saw that through laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of this, thy wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness, and in the bond of iniquity. Then answered Simon and said, Pray ye to the Lord for me, that none of these things which you have spoken come upon me. And the next verse doesn't have a whole lot to do with specifically to this story, but it makes a point. So in the next verse it says, And they, when they had testified and preached the word of the Lord, returned to Jerusalem and preached the gospel in many villages of the Samaritans. It's kind of like when somebody asks you a question, and you hear what they're asking for, and then you're like, okay, and you move right along. I mean, to me, that's how it looks. That's how it looks. It's like, okay, he's asking them to pray with him. They already told him to repent, but there is no record in Scripture where he repented, where they show that he repented. So I don't want to assume anything, but there is history, some history that is saying, you know, what went on, you know, after that account, you know, what happened with Simon Magus the sorcerer. But, and we're going to get into that some. So in the city of Samaria, Simon the sorcerer, in verses 10 through 11, we saw that where they introduce him. And then people gave heed and regard. People, in verses 10 through 11, people gave heed and regard. The Greek word there is proseko, which means to hold the mind. Figuratively speaking, to hold the mind, to apply oneself to adhere to, devotion of thought and effort to a thing. They were like really, really intensely applying themselves to what he was pushing out there, what he was doing. And of course, he was casting spells on them in the process. So how much of that was truly authentic on their part, you know, like their following, is questionable. Absolute darkness cannot remain in the presence of absolute light, nor does darkness have the ability to generate. Now, I see that coming out of this story, but also at the same time, there are certain characteristics about light and darkness, and some of it's very simple. You know, I certainly don't want to try to dazzle you, because that's not going to happen. But the light, in contrast with the darkness. Darkness is the absence of light, right?
Yeah.
How many of you knew that?
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. But the fact of the matter is, if we turn the lights off in this room, and I mean everything, and we seal all the doors, and I mean everything is sealed, no cracks, no way visibly that we know light could get in, did you realize that there is still light in the room? That's a known fact. Infrared light cannot be seen with the visible eye. You know, a certain type of infrared light. Ultraviolet light at a certain capacity cannot even be seen with the visible eye, but it's light. And looking through certain lens, you can see, and it is light. And so I believe that that is the case for a specific reason, because it correlates. It correlates. In every situation, in every circumstance that we face, God is there. He is there. It may not be manifested in a visible way, you know, that's real obvious, but he's there. He's there in that situation. And so that means also that there's always a way out. And we know which way to look. We look up and we look to the cross. Because that is the power. That's the generated power. But darkness, and I'm sure you've heard it many times, darkness is not a thing where light is actually something. Darkness is not something, it's the absence of something, right? So darkness doesn't have the ability, and we're talking with the literal, okay, in the natural. Darkness doesn't have the ability to reproduce. You want more darkness? Take back away more light. That's the only way you can have more darkness. And that's how it was with Simon Magus, this sorcerer. As long as the light wasn't around, he was able to, you know, have a large gathering. But as soon as the light came in, he was losing ground like you wouldn't believe. And that's one of the characteristics of darkness and light. There were two buts, two big buts that I saw in that scripture. Acts, still in the same chapter 8, verse 9. That's the first but. So they were talking about... They were talking about Saul, how he was actually the one that was standing there whenever they stoned Stephen, right? That was Paul.
Yeah.
That was before his name was changed, okay, at the beginning of chapter 8. He was consenting to it. He was giving his approval to it. And so he's on the scene. And then Philip's also preaching the gospel, and miracles and signs and wonders were happening. And there was joy in the city, it says in verse 8. And in verse 9 it says, But there was a certain man called Simon. And so we just read the story as to what actually happened. And so you know what it means when you see the word "but," right? It's a pretty simple word. I know we all are fully aware, but it's I think one of the best ways to illustrate is if you have a boyfriend or a girlfriend, and they're ready to break off the relationship, and they come to you and they tell you how good looking you are, how cute you are, and they love your personality, and they think you're a great guy, you're a great girl, but. You know what that means, right? Everything that they said before that, it pretty much doesn't really matter anymore. And so that's what it means right there. This is the little but. Verse 9 is the little but. There was joy in the city, but Simon, you know, that was his city, right? He was from there before they came in with the gospel, before Jesus had died on the cross and then came back and then met with them in that place that he met with them in. And commanded them, and then the Holy Spirit fell, and you know, we went through all that real quickly. Before all those events happened, that was Simon's place. That was his territory. And he was gaining ground. And then Philip comes into the area, and some of the other disciples come into Samaria, and they start preaching the gospel. And so that leads us to the next but, verse 12. So they were talking about Simon. And everything that's going on, verse 11, the backup one, and to him they had regard, because that of a long time he had bewitched them with sorceries. But when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. And I know it's been said, you know, over here many times before, when you see references like that to the name of Jesus Christ, they were preaching the cross. They were preaching the message of what had happened. That's what they were preaching, okay? They weren't just talking about Jesus and that's all. They were talking about what he had done for them to bring salvation. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason why we see these salvations, the 3,000, the 5,000 that were actually converted to Christ. And that's the thing, you know, darkness, it kind of has a power to it, you know, because if you're in darkness, and talking in the natural, if you're in darkness, I mean, you can be tripping all over the place. It really can debilitate, you know, your movements. You know, it can really hinder, you know, what you're able to accomplish. And then when the light turns on, everything changes. And that's the best way that I know how to explain that. You know, that's the difference. Although he had that stronghold in the city, when Philip came in and he started preaching and he started sharing the gospel, everything changed. It didn't matter. Everything that Simon Magus was doing didn't matter anymore, because people were getting delivered. Demons were being cast out of people from those sorceries and spells that he was casting on people. And when he tried to purchase the power of the Holy Spirit, and that's really just a lack of knowledge and a lack of understanding, he had already believed. He had already accepted the message. And yet now, you know, at that point, he was trying to purchase the power of the Holy Spirit. So being just simply a matter of not understanding, you know, that's not how it works, buddy. I mean, it just doesn't work that way, you know. And seeking it for the wrong reasons. I wanted to move on to a little bit of the history. I don't know if y'all have heard Pastor mention Eusebius. But Eusebius is a guy that lived 263 AD. That's when he was born, all the way to 339 AD. So he's one of the guys from way back. And he has some written accounts of what actually happened with Simon Magus. He finishes telling some of the story of what happened. It's really powerful. I'm going to read some of this to you. the faith of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, having now been diffused abroad among all men, the enemy of salvation, devising some scheme of seizing upon the imperial city for himself, brought hither Simon, whom we mentioned before. Coming to the aid of his insidious artifices, he attached many of the inhabitants of Rome to himself in order to deceive them. This is attested by Justin, who was one of our distinguished writers not long after the times of the apostles, concerning whom I shall say what is necessary in the proper place. The reader may see for himself in the first defense of our religion, addressed to Antonine, where he wrote thus, "And after the ascension of our Lord into heaven, certain men were suborned by demons as their agents." Suborned meaning they were bribed or they were induced. They were taken over by demons. They were suborned by demons as their agents, who said that they were gods. These were not only suffered to pass without persecution, but were even deemed worthy of honors by you. Simon, a certain Samaritan of the village called Githon, was one of the number who, in the reign of Claudius Caesar, performed many magic rites by the operation of demons, was considered a god in your imperial city of Rome, and was honored by you with a statue as a god. In the river Tiber, on an island, between the two bridges, he's really breaking it down, isn't he? Having the superscription in Latin, Simoni Deo Sancto, which is to Simon the Holy God. And nearly all the Samaritans, a few also of other nations, worship him, confessing him as a supreme God. A certain Helen also is of this class, who had before been a public prostitute in Tyre of Phoenicia, and at that time attached herself to Simon and was called the first idea that proceeded from him. Such is the testimony of Justin, with which also Irenaeus coincided in his first book against heresies, where he also added an account of the impiety and corrupt doctrine of the man, which it would be superfluous for us to detail, as it is in the power of those who wish to learn the origin, the lives, and the false doctrines, not only of this one, but likewise of all the heresiarchs, respectively. I notice they refer to those who are like founders of heresy. They call them heresiarchs, kind of like we call Abraham one of our patriarchs, because he's one of the guys that God used. He is the one that God chose initially as the founder of the Jewish race and our faith. As also of the institutions and principles of all of them treated at large in the above mentioned book of Irenaeus. Simon, however, we have understood to have taken the lead in all heresy. Isn't that interesting? Simon, however, we have understood to have taken the lead in all heresy, from whom also, down to the present time, those who followed his heresy still affected the modest philosophy of the Christians, so celebrated for purity of life among all. From this, however, they appeared again to depart and again to embrace the superstitions of idols, falling down before the pictures and statues of this selfsame Simon and the aforesaid Helen with him, venturing to offer them worship by incense, sacrifices, and libations. Those matters which are kept more secret by them than these, at the first mention of which they say one would be astonished, and to use an oracular phrase with them would be confounded. And it goes on and goes on. Such was the wickedness of which that malignant power, the enemy of all good and the waylayer of human salvation, constituted Simon, the father and author at this time, as if with a view to make him a great and powerful antagonist to the divine purposes of our Savior and his apostles. Nevertheless, the divine and celestial grace which cooperates with its servants by their appearance and presence soon extinguished the flame that had been kindled by the wicked one, humbling and casting down through them every height that elevated itself against the knowledge of God. Wherefore, neither the conspiracy of Simon nor that of any other one then existing was able to effect anything against those apostolic times. The declaration of the truth prevailed and overpowered all, and the divine word itself, now shining from heaven upon men flourishing upon earth and dwelling with his apostles, prevailed and overpowered every opposition. Immediately the aforesaid impostor, being smitten as to his mental eye by a divine and supernatural brilliancy, as when on a former occasion in Judea, he was convicted of his wickedness by the apostle Peter. He undertook a great journey from the east across the sea and fled to the west, thinking that this was the only way for him to live according to his mind. He was trying to get away from Peter, John, and the other apostles. Entering the city of Rome by the cooperation of that malignant spirit which had fixed its seat there, his attempts were soon so far successful as to be honored as a god. So what he had accomplished in Samaria, he accomplished over here with the erection of a statue by the inhabitants of that city in Rome. This, however, did not continue long. Immediately under the reign of Claudius, by benign and gracious providence of God, Peter, that powerful and great apostle, who by his courage took the lead of all the rest, was conducted to Rome against this pest of mankind. He, like a noble commander of God, fortified with divine armor, bore the precious merchandise of the revealed light from the east to those in the west, announcing the light itself and salutary doctrine of the soul, the proclamation of the kingdom of God. And so that's his account of what happened, you know, the end of that story, which I thought was pretty interesting. That's what darkness is going to do. You know, when we turn on the light in the room, it runs, and darkness is going to go somewhere else. And so we need to be aware of it. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7 says, "In whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us." That was 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. I thought it was interesting because when I was looking at that particular scripture, it mentions world. It says, "In whom the God of this world." Now, I always thought that word world there was talking about the world as we know it, but that's not at all what he was talking about. The word, the Greek word there is aion. And it has different contexts that it could take, but it's generally, overall, it's generally a certain meaning, an age time or a duration of time. It could be indefinite or it could be limited. So it's speaking of time. It's not speaking of the earth or just people in this, you know, in this realm that we're in. It's from the root word olam, which means a concealed duration of time. And I see where that applies, because here the devil is, he's doing his thing. You know, he's the God of this world. But there's a duration of his time in this world. There's a duration. There's an expiration that's going to come. It is concealed because we don't know what it is. I don't know if he knows what it is, but God certainly knows. And so the light that's shining, it is still shining regardless of the fact that he is the God of this world. He took Jesus up to that mountain, you know, to the top of the pinnacle and on the mountain, and he showed them the kingdoms of the world, and he offered it to him because it's his. It was already given to him. But the amount of darkness is only known by measuring the amount of light. It's the only way to measure darkness. Because remember, darkness is not a thing per se. Light is something, but darkness is not. So that's the only way we can measure darkness. Is by, okay, so how much light is in the room or not in the room? The kingdom of darkness can do nothing without God's light. That's the whole point. He cannot do anything without God's light. But his ability to function is because God is light. The breath that he has in his body is because God is light. And so it's crazy. It's no wonder, like it was preached this morning, it was mentioned, or whenever it was mentioned about David, you know, going before Goliath. You know, I mean, what's the problem? You know, I mean, what's the problem with Goliath? You know, why is no one coming out to meet him? You know, when you truly understand God and you understand, you know, that aspect of him, I mean, we're still trying to learn everything about him, the manifold wisdom of God, the many-sided wisdom of God. But when we really understand that aspect of God, it really does change our approach to the enemy. It changes our approach to the darkness that's around us. And just knowing that there is no cases of total absence of light, it gives me encouragement knowing that